our living hope. He is alive. He defeated, he conquered death, hell, and the grave, and he is seated on the right hand of God the Father, making intercession for us even now. Praise his holy name. Amen.
Christ, my living hope. today, if you've come here today and that you have a sickness in your body, I believe God can heal you through communion. Because when you take the Lord's body, when Scripture says that He was wounded for your transgression, He was bruised for your iniquities, and the punishment, the chastisement for your peace was upon Him, and by His stripes you're healed. When we take the body of Christ, we can claim that healing because we're taking the stripes that He bore into us. Friends, so if you come today, I want you to just encourage you today to reach out in faith and believe God for your healing. Whatever it is. Whatever. Now, I believe in laying on hands. Scripture tells us to lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. Does it not?
Amen.
But I also believe that sometimes you don't have to touch them. Because the power of God in our lives can heal someone or heal ourselves. Hello. So I want to encourage you in that. Scripture says that on the night that He was betrayed, He took the bread and He blessed it and He broke it. And He said, "Take, eat. This is My body which was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." Today, as we take the bread or that little styrofoam wafer, we're going to take Him as remembering what He's done for us. How His body was broken for us. How He endured the suffering of the cross for us. It was for our benefit. Every lash that He took, every beating that He took, the crown of thorns that was pressed on His head, He did that for you and me, friends. So, Father, we just thank You. We thank You for the body of Christ, which was broken for us. And so today we take this in remembrance of the work of Christ in our lives. We thank You, Father, that You sent Your Son because You loved us. And we are the benefactor of Your love. We are the ones who receive. We are the ones who benefit because You loved us first. So, Father, today we receive this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. As you take it, declare, "He did this for me." Included me. Me as a Gentile got included in this bargain. I don't have to rely on works. Works can't save me, so I don't have to rely on them. Now, I'm not saying works are a bad thing, but I'm telling you, my works come because of my salvation, not in order to receive. So I'm thankful for the blood of Jesus Christ. As the hymn says, "What could wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus." So today, Father, we take this cup, symbolizing the blood of Jesus Christ that was poured out for us. We thank You that there is life in the blood. Today we receive this into ourselves, thanking You for that salvation that we now have, that You have called us, You have saved us. And God, we also declare to those around us, Jesus is coming soon. And until He comes, our goal, our mission, is to save as many through this blood as we can. So Father, we just receive this today in the name of the one name that is above every name, name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Take the cup.
today that you're saved. Are you glad you're saved? Thank you. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for saving us from the pit. Thank you for redeeming us from our sins and washing them away as far as the east is from the west. God, we thank you. God, we praise you. You are great and great.
Hallelujah.
My message this morning, it's a two-part message, both today, by the way, but I don't know. God, you do what you want. It's called Devil, You Can't Take My Breath. We give the devil way too much power, way too much credit, way too much authority in our lives. We really do. We give him credit for something sometimes that's our fault. Hello. Everything you're going through is not the result of sin. Sometimes it's your own fault. Okay? Sometimes we just mess, and we do because we're human. Okay? None of us are exempt from this. There's none of us that are perfect. None of us has made the right choices in our entire life. None. But I want you to see something today that goes beyond. I was praying the other day, and the Lord just really began to speak to me about it. If you would this morning, let's turn to the book of Job. This is the book that if you're unemployed, you read this book. Job. The book of Job, chapter 1. We're going to start in verse 6. And if you can stand and say amen and do it loudly. Job, chapter 1, verse 6.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. We're not equal here. We're not having a woman either. Sorry. Job chapter 1, starting in verse 6. No, we are equal, but you know what I mean. Starting in verse 6. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. And the Lord said unto Satan, Whence comest thou? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, From going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down in it. And the Lord said unto Satan, Hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, Doth Job fear God for naught? Hast thou made a hedge about him, and about his house, and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land. But put forth thy hand now, and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face. And the Lord said unto Satan, Behold, all that he hath is in thy power, only upon himself put not forth thy hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. Let's pray. Wonderful Father that you are, we love you. Thank you for bringing us together in this place at this time. Now, Father, as we've gathered here under the banner of Christ, we pray that we hear from you, we hear from heaven, that we don't hear mere words, we don't hear works, but we hear what you have given us so freely. Father, cause your word to be enlightened into our life. Cause it to light up. Make it light up on our lives so that we may see, hear, and understand what you would speak to each one of our hearts. So we thank you again today, Father. Bless your word that is anointed because it will not return void. It accomplishes the task that it was set forth to do. So we bless you and we thank you today. Speak to our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And amen. be seated.
I'm going to get into all of this, but what a powerful word of Job. That when Satan is talking to God, and I believe, by the way, a lot of things we attribute to Satan aren't really Satan, okay? Because Satan is one individual. He is not omnipresent. I want you to understand that. Satan can't be everywhere at all the time because he's not God. Okay? Get that? A lot of people say, oh, Satan's attacking me. Well, probably not. I'm not saying it's not one of his imps or demons or, you know, I'm not saying that. I'm saying probably Satan is not going to attack any of us personally. He will attack us through his devices and his delegation. That makes sense? His demons or whatever can come and attack us and oppress us as believers. Oh, I'm not even going to get at that. That would just take me on a whole nother bunny trail. But the fact that Satan in person is probably not going to attack you. I want you to understand that. But in this case, Satan himself, proper name, came before God, and he stood before God, and God asked him a question. He said, where are you coming from? Satan says, well, I've been walking around the earth. Been walking around and looking. He looked at the dirt. Jerry. Yeah. He looked. You see, the Bible calls him the accuser of the brethren. So how can he accuse us unless he has evidence? Think about it. And because none of us are perfect, do we often have problems? So Satan was going around looking at people, trying to find where they made a mistake, where they messed up, where they got, you know, oh, you shouldn't have said that, or you shouldn't have done that. Satan just stores those things up. He said, I was all around the earth, and I was looking, walking through it. He's basically trying to find some dirt on God's people. Oh, let me tell you, friends, not all of your friends are friends. Some of your friends are just out to get dirt on you. Sometimes they want the goods on you, so they can go back and they can tell someone else or whatever. Now, don't trust everybody. So he's going around, comes to heaven, and God says, where have you been? He said, I've been looking around. I've been looking at your people. That just like saying, boy, there's Christians at Harvest Baptist. They think they're so good. They think they got it all together. Hello, friends. I have it less together more than I have it together, okay? You probably do too. But the devil likes to come against you and find things that are wrong. And so here's the confidence God had in Job. He says, did you consider him? Did you think about him? Did you see? Did you spy on Job yet? Job is a righteous man. God bragged on Job. Oh, he's a good guy. He's perfect. He's honorable. He has integrity. Think about Job yet? Satan didn't like that. Because he didn't, at that point, he had no dirt on Job. He had nothing to accuse Job of. In fact, when he asked him, he says in verse 8, there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil. Loved God, hated evil. Satan was mad because he was the one person on the earth that he didn't have anything on, that he couldn't say, well, did you see what he did yesterday? Yeah. Did you know what he really did? Of course, God knows everything. So, but he says in verse 10, hast thou not made a hedge about him and about his house and about all that he hath on every side, that thou hast blessed his work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land? He's saying the only reason Job is perfect in your sight is because you have made everything good in his life. How many know some of our days are not good? And I believe God can put a hedge about us. I believe that. I believe you pray that. But not every day is perfect. Well, according to the devil, according to Satan, God put a hedge about Job. He increased everything that he had. And because of that, Job was walking in perfection and integrity. Now, I want you to see something maybe you've never seen before. Verse 11, he says, Satan talking to God, he says, but put forth thine hand now, and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face. In other words, get rid of it. Get rid of all those wonderful blessings. And it's easy to praise God when everything's going good. But it's more important to praise God when things are not. He says, Satan tells God, listen to me. Put forth thy hand. In other words, he's telling God, you take it all away. You touch him. Now, see, here's something important. God does not hurt you. I want you to see this. See, Satan wanted God to put forth his hand to touch Job. God didn't. You see, when you think, oh, all these things that are happening in your life that God did it, God didn't do it. Satan tempted us, believe me, this is a tempt. He tempted God to touch Job's life and to take all those things back. And God says, I'm not going to do it. He's my son. Think about that. Think about that. He didn't. God says, nope, not going to touch him. He's my child. But the Lord, in verse 12, look at this, said unto Satan, behold, all that he hath, underline that or highlight that in your Bible, all that he hath is in thy power. Only upon himself put not forth thine hand. So God said, I'm not going to touch him. He said, but I am going to give you permission to do it. However, you can only touch what he has, not who he is. He gave Satan permission to touch things in his life. But he couldn't touch him. I'm going somewhere with this, friends. God was not tempted by Satan to reach out and hurt Job because he was his child. God does the same thing with you. He says, I ain't touching you. I love you. When I reach out, I'm going to bless you. His mercy may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. He says, all that he hath is in thy power, only upon himself put not forth thy hand. So he went from the presence of the Lord. That word, and I'll get this, I want you to remember this. The word when he said, put forth not thy hand, that word means, one of the meanings is to loose. In other words, he told Satan, you can loose things on his life, but you can't touch him. In other words, you can't touch his breath. You see, as I was praying and the Lord was speaking about this scripture today, I came to the conclusion that the devil can touch things in our lives, but he has no power over your breath. Because God gave breath to your life, and Satan can't take it away. Oh, come on. Friends, no one passes from this life into an eternity without God saying, yes.
Amen.
Now, this may seem a little radical, and I'm not condoning this, please, by no means. But hear this. Stand out. Now, I'm not telling you to. Someone would stand out on the interstate in front of a tractor trailer and say, hit me! Hit me! The only way that you can lose your life is if God says, yeah, he's stupid enough, let's bring him home. So to speak, only if God says it. We give the devil too much power, and we give ourselves too much power sometimes, but only God who gave your life can take your life.
Amen.
Remember the old saying moms used to say, I brought you into this world and I take you out of it? Well, God gave you breath, did he not, in Genesis? Say, so he breathed into man the breath of life, and he became a living soul. Who can take our breath but God? Because he is the one who gave it. So he told Satan, or God told Satan, he said, touch, loose those things from his life. Loose those things from his life. But you can't take his breath. You can't take his life. He's mine. I want you to see that. I want you to see that God declares that you are his, and Satan has no authority over that life.
Amen.
He can loose things from our lives. And sometimes we think we hold on to things and they're really not in our group too good. And they go. Things. He said, take those things that he hath. Those things that are around him and surrounding him. If you read the story, you'll understand that he lost everything. Job was a wealthy man. Had lots of cattle. Read above and on. All the cattle he had. Everything that he had. Job was a wealthy man. He lost his kids. He lost all his livestock. Everything that, honestly, in the light of eternity, means nothing. Seriously. It's nice to have things, but in reality, in the light of eternity, bless you, they don't save you, nor can they keep you saved. The thing. We all have our things that we like, that we hold on to dear. We all have something that if God said, I want it, give it to me, we would have a hard time doing it. Everybody has something. I'm not saying we wouldn't, but we would struggle with it. Remember the story of Abraham and Isaac? His one and only son. God says, I want it. I want to sacrifice your son Isaac to me. I love that story because here's this young lad carrying the wood up this mountain. He wasn't a dumb boy. He says, hey Dad, I'm carrying wood. We've got fire. Where's the sacrifice? Not a dumb boy. And his dad shares the word of faith. God. I'm not condoning this, but please, when God asks, there are things that we have that may take a little more struggle to get rid of. God says to Job, you can touch his things, but you cannot loosen his life. Ecclesiastes talks about Ecclesiastes talks about when our life is ended and that silver cord is loosened and our spirit goes back to God. You see, only God can take that away. First part of this message, I want you to hear and understand that whatever Satan tries on you, he can't touch your life. He may touch things, but God is the only one. I don't care if you're in, I don't care what situation you're in. Your life is in God's hands, and only God's hands. that gives you some security to me. When I think about that, I think Satan can touch my life, but he can't touch me. He can't touch me. I'm going to go when God says it's my time. I don't care what your health situation is. I don't care whatever situation you're in. You're going to go when God says it's time, not until.
Amen.
So find yourself in that place, a place of security. I read about Paul in the New Testament about how he knew that if he went to Jerusalem, he was going to get into trouble. In fact, the prophet Agabus took his belt and tied it around and said, the person to whom this belt belongs to is going to go into Jerusalem and you're going to suffer many, I'm just paraphrasing, you're going to suffer many things. And what did Paul do? The apostle Paul, he still went to Jerusalem. Why? Because he knew all these other things that could happen to him, God had a time on his life. And no matter what the enemy, no matter what the Pharisees, and no matter what all these people who were trying to kill him, they couldn't take his life. Matter of fact, they thought they did once. Beat him up to a pulp, thought he was dead. The apostle Paul. He survived. They lowered him out of the town in a basket, and he lived. They had left him for dead. You see, when we understand our calling and when we understand who we are in Christ, that we're a child of God, we should come to the conclusion that can't touch me, devil. I'm going to go what God says. I may suffer things, I may deal with things, but it's not my time. Are you getting this, Vince? The devil can't take your breath. He may take things out of your life, but he can't take your breath. Now, if you would. Remember that what I told you when he said, all that you have is in thy power, only upon himself put not forth thy hand. Remember what I said that really means? It means to loose. Okay? The devil could loose things from his life, but he couldn't take his life. Let's go to the book of Matthew in the New Testament, chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16, verse 19. I want you to see this today. Matthew 16, verse 19. Jesus, this is after the revelation of Peter that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Peter says, or Jesus says to Peter, I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever thou bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Oh, friends, the authority, that breath that God put in us, we now have the authority to speak with that same breath. Think about this. While we have breath, he says, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed on heaven. In other words, at your words, at your breath, whatever you say here, God acknowledges and does in heaven. He said, whatever you bind on earth, come on, church. I really want us to understand this. Because he's saying that same breath that I have given you, in you speak out and begin to bind things and begin to loose things. You have that authority.
Amen.
He says, I gave you breath. You breathe that breath in. Remember when Jesus was being tempted? Jesus told the devil that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. When a word comes from God, he breathes it out, we breathe it in, and we breathe it back out again. Oh, glory to God. The authority that we have in our testimony. This is why we did testimony just a little bit ago. The authority that we have in our testimony is to breathe out the power of God. It is to breathe out what we bind on earth will be bound in heaven. To breathe out what we loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. I'm telling you, friends, we need to loose some things from our life and we need to bind some things to our life. Hello. Devil tries to come against us. I'm not perfect in this. I doubt any of you are either. The devil brings things in our life and we let them attach to us. We give them a place. We let them set up residence in the house. This house. When he's saying, loose them. Because when you lose something here, I will verify it and stand behind it in heaven. Are we getting this? That what we lose from our life, God says, I'm going to honor it. We need to begin loosening some things out of our life. You ever see those ships that have those barnacles on it? It's tough once they get set in to get rid of them, isn't it? See, as Christians, we need to get rid of them as soon as possible. Don't let them set up residence in our life. So with that same breath that we took in, we now breathe out the authority of God in our breath. Oh, come on. We breathe out the authority of God through our breath. Because he said, whatever you loose or whatever you bind on earth, I'm going to do the same in heaven. In other words, I'm going to verify it. It's going to take place in your life. You see, God gave us breath to take in. And because of that breath, we're alive today. Amen. Are we alive? I'm wondering here. Because of the breath that he breathed into us, we're alive today. But we can't just sit back and but as we breathe out, we breathe the power and the authority, the breath of God into our situations, into our life. Don't complain about it. Loose it from your life. Don't complain about it. Bind it from your life. Now, we all get into those woe is me modes. We all get there sometime or another sometimes. But I'm telling you, as a believer in Christ, our authority to speak, to loose out the breath of God over our situation has been given to us. Don't give the devil a foothold in your life. When these things come in, begin to speak the word of God over the situation. Telling someone this morning, they asked me how I was doing, and I said, and I used to say this a lot, and I kind of got out of the habit of doing it, but bless God, I need to start speaking it more. I'm blessed and highly favored. Amen. You're blessed and highly favored. You really are. The favor of God can rest upon you. There's things that are in your life, and please, believe me, I understand. It's life, and life isn't always perfect. But I also believe that he has called us to live an abundant life in him. How do we live that abundant life? We begin to speak, breathe out what God has already breathed into us. God told Job, or God told Satan, you can touch things. But you can't loosen his life. Loose things out of his life, but you can't loosen his life. He's telling you the same thing. But he's saying, when you breathe in me, I want you to begin to breathe out me. Breathe out my word. Breathe out what thus saith the Lord. some graphics when we were talking about what is going on in the Ukraine. If you, doesn't matter, I'm not promoting any system, but you listen to anybody, any news on TV, and they will all give you their opinions. Lots of opinions going on out there. Good, bad, indifferent. There's just, everybody has their opinion. They bring in the specialists and the generals and all, they bring in their opinion. But let me just tell you something, friends. When I talk to God, I don't get an opinion. I get His Word. And I don't know, I'm not going to predict what is going on over there. We can look at the signs and we can understand certain things from the scripture. But let me just tell you something. It's all in God's hands. It's all in God's hands. I was praying the other day about what was happening in the Ukraine. And this is just, all the bombings, people that have died. You know, my first thought in prayer was, how many people got bombed and died and lost their lives and ended up in hell? Think about that. Nations rise and fall, friends. Israel, great, not so great, great, not so great, not so great. The United States has been a great force for evangelism across the world. But I'm here to tell you that if we don't honor God, we won't be so great. So I don't care what necessarily, I mean, there's compassion for what's going on there. But honestly, it's all in God's hands. God can cause a nation to rise and a nation to fall. God can cause all these things. And I believe the time is near, and it's all leading the way up until the end times. We're in the end times. But I believe it's all paving the path. But ultimately, on God's hands. You don't need my opinion on it. You don't even need me up here telling you, thus saith the Lord. I've heard so many people say, oh, this is what God's saying now. This is what God's saying now. You know what God's saying? Get ready, church. Get the word out. Get souls saved. That's what the church really needs to hear. In fact, what the church really needs to hear is, to the church, you better get ready. There's a lot of people sitting in churches today that aren't ready. They don't have a relationship or fellowship with God. You see, friends, we have been given the authority to speak the words of God. When the Great Commission, when Christ gave the Great Commission, He said to go. And He said, you will speak with new tongues. Did He not? Now, I believe in the gifts of the Spirit. And I believe in the gift of tongues and interpretation. I believe that. But I don't necessarily mean to believe that that's all that He meant by that. See, the church, what it needs to be speaking is, God loves you. He has a plan for you. And He wants to save you. See, we don't sometimes have that tongue. It's a lot of times, boy, that preacher would just shut up. Or, boy, that person did this. Or, boy, we need to speak with new tongues and declare the goodness of God. And as I was sharing last week from the book of Joel, we need to begin to believe and speak the word that all who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's our mission. That's what we need to be speaking. Our prayer should be more about, now I'm not saying we can't pray for certain things. Believe me, I believe we can pray for whatever. But I believe our prayer should be more geared towards, save them, God. Because a lot of people are going to hell. I can endure a little bit of pain in the moment. It's all temporary anyhow, right? I can endure a little bit of, now please, sometimes it comes overwhelming, like, Jesus, help. I get that. We all get to that place in some ways. But I can endure a little bit of pain for now. For now. But there are those who are sitting in churches, who are listening to TV preachers or wherever they're at today, or people that is in your family or your neighbors or people you work with that are going to have to spend eternity in hell.
because they didn't breathe in Jesus. Come on. That's more important than anything. I can deal with temporary things, but my hope is in Jesus. And I know without a doubt, as a matter of fact, that when he does say, I'm taking the breath, I'm going to spend an eternity in heaven with him. I know that. That's what the word says. And as the song says, my hope is built in nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. Friends, I want to tell you, breathe in Jesus. The devil can't touch your breath. Breathe out Jesus and watch things be bound and loosened in your life and those around you. Let's pray. God, I just thank you. I thank you for that breath. I thank you that the devil, you can't take my breath. It was given to me by God. And I thank you that as I breathe out Jesus, you tremble at it. As I breathe out his word, you tremble at the word. God, we thank you for that breath that you've given us. Now help us, Father, to begin to breathe it out, to begin to bind and begin to loosen, and you will honor it in heaven. You will honor those words. Thank you that we can be like Elijah. We can be like that prophet who spoke, who prayed, and it didn't rain for 3.5 years. And then prayed again, and it did rain. Teach us the authority that we have in that breath that you've given us. So we thank you this morning. We bless you. Holy Spirit, stir it up in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.